Alright, this is ABSITE and board review for anal diseases. Colon and rectum is covered in a different video, be sure to check that one out. I had help putting this one together from Dr. Olga Garcia, who is a prior resident of mine and currently about to graduate from colorectal surgery fellowship at Case Western Reserve in Cleveland, so thanks to her. Let's talk about some anatomy first. The surgical anal canal is defined by the sphincter complex and extends from the anal verge to the top of the anal rectal ring, defined by sphincter muscles. The length can range from 3 to 5 centimeters, with women tending to have shorter ones. Understanding the anatomy is crucial to treating anal diseases such as fistulas and abscesses. The dentate or pectinate line is located at the level of the columns of Morgagni, which contain the anal crypts responsible for perianal abscesses and fistulas. Proximal to it is the anal transition zone farther above, which is columnar epithelium that makes adenocarcinoma. The anoderm is distal to the dentate line and is lined by non-keratinized squamous epithelium, so it makes squamous cell cancers. The dentate is important because it is a margin for different innervation, blood supply, and venous and lymphatic drainage, as well as the presence below or lack of above it sensation. Lower rectum can have lymphatic drainage to internal iliac nodes and sometimes the inguinal nodes, whereas the anal canal primarily drains to inguinal lymph nodes. The anoderm is where dysplasia most commonly arises. The term anatomic anal canal usually just refers to the canal below the dentate line, as opposed to the surgical anal canal, which goes to the top of the sphincter muscles. The external anal sphincter is an extension of the levator ani muscles, specifically the puborectalis muscle, and has three portions called the deep, superficial, and subcutaneous. At rest, the puborectalis muscle makes a sling around the distal rectum, forming an acute angle, and with defecation, the muscle relaxes, allowing the anal rectal junction to straighten out. The external anal sphincter is under voluntary control. The internal anal sphincter is a continuation of the muscularis propria of the rectal wall and is under involuntary control. The groove between the two can be felt as the intersphincteric groove on the anal margin skin. Rectal distension causes the internal anal sphincter to involuntarily relax and the external anal sphincter to contract. This is called the RAIR, or rare reflex. This is absent in Hirschsprung's disease, since the Meissner's are submucosal and the Auerbach's or the myenteric plexuses are missing. Hemorrhoids are classified as internal, which are above the dentate line, and external, below the dentate line. Internal hemorrhoids are painless and are the ones prone to bleeding. Cirrhotics with portal hypertension get internal hemorrhoids from pressure in the IMV down to the superior hemorrhoidal veins and can have massive internal hemorrhoidal bleeding. Internal hemorrhoids are the ones you band, inject, or staple, not the external ones because that would hurt. Internal hemorrhoids are the ones that have the grading system. Grade 1, no protrusion from the anus. Grade 2, protrudes from the anus but spontaneously reduces. Grade 3, need manual reduction. Grade 4, you cannot reduce. The internal hemorrhoids are the ones that have the left anterior, left posterior, and right lateral ones. External hemorrhoids hurt since there is somatic nerves below the dentate line. These are the hemorrhoids that get thrombosed and painful. If this is less than 72 hours old, you can do surgical excision. But if the patient presents after 72 hours, they're on the downslope of the curve of pain severity and should wait it out with stool softeners and sitz baths. Chronic hemorrhoids can cause irritation and may be a reason to do surgical excision. Always send the specimen to pathology in case there is some undiagnosed malignancy, like squamous cell cancer or anal melanoma. In external hemorrhoidal crisis, which are engorged prolapse and strangulated circumferential external hemorrhoids, apply sugar and ice packs in 15-minute intervals with a goal to reduce. Sometimes you may even need paralysis under anesthesia to achieve this. But do not operate acutely. You will end up excising too much tissue and can cause anal stenosis. Recently, hyaluronic acid has also been used successfully. Next, rectal prolapse. Rectal prolapse is more common in elderly women. The classic question is that there are concentric folds that differentiate rectal prolapse from the linear folds in a prolapsing hemorrhoid. Rectal prolapse is treated in a good surgical candidate by transabdominal rectopexy and possible sigmoid resection if there is an element of chronic constipation or an elongated sigmoid. That can be a point of argument, though. In a poor operative candidate, an old frail person, say, these are where you talk about the Altmaier or the Delorme procedure. These are basically resection of the prolapsed rectum from the perineum. In an Altmaier, you do a true coloanal hand-sewn anastomosis. In a Delorme, you do a mucosal resection with a muscular plication. Anal abscesses and fistula in ano are common questions and are common referrals to general surgeons. It is thought that they start by bacteria getting into anal crypts near the dentate line, so sometimes abscesses, once they are drained, can continue to drain, which suggests a fistula in ano. Know the types of abscesses in relationship to the sphincter muscles and the levator muscles. If an abscess above the levators, then it is a supralevator abscess. If it is between the internal and external anal sphincters, then it is an intersphincteric abscess. If it is outside of the external anal sphincter, then it is an ischiorectal abscess. And if it is just under the skin or mucosa, then it is a simple subcutaneous perianal abscess. Classification of fistula in ano again depends on the sphincter muscles. Suprasphincteric is above the sphincters. Transsphincteric traverses right through the sphincters. Intersphincteric runs between the internal and external sphincters. Submucosal doesn't go past the muscle at all. The internal opening of the fistula can be found using Goodsall's rule. Anterior ones take a straight line to the internal opening. Posterior to the midline take a curved path, ending up with the posterior midline internal opening. Goodsall's rule does not work if the external opening is more than 2 centimeters from the anal verge. Submucosal and intersphincteric and low transsphincteric can be simply opened up to treat the fistula. Suprasphincteric and high transsphincteric, you do not want to cut too much muscle, which could cause incontinence. So then you use things like non-cutting setons, which are placed for 6 weeks, followed by a curette of the tract or perhaps a mucosal advancement flap with ligation of the tract. A cutting seton is no longer used due to high risk of incontinence and how painful they are. Anal fissures are painful and related to constipation. Anal fissures are a common source of rectal bleeding in children. They are usually in the posterior midline. They can have a sentinel pile, which is basically a skin tag near the external extent of it. Lateral anal fissures make you think of Crohn's disease or HIV. In adults, if anal fissure is acutely onset, then treat it conservatively with stool softeners and sitz baths. Once it has been present for longer than 6 weeks and resistant to conservative measures, then you may have to do something about it. Some talk about how Botox injection works, but the classic surgery is the lateral internal sphincterotomy. This is done by palpating the intersphincteric groove laterally. You place an 11 blade between the internal external sphincter muscles. Then you turn the blade medially to cut the internal anal sphincter and spare the mucosa. Anal cancer refers to squamous cell cancer of the anal canal. The lining of the rectum is glandular mucosa, which makes adenocarcinoma. Then at the dentate line, you transition to non-keratinized squamous cells, which lines the anal canal. Then at the edge of the anal margin, you transition again to keratinized hair-bearing squamous cells. Squamous cell carcinoma of the anal canal, related to HPV, is probably a good idea to screen women for cervical cancer also, if they have this. Squamous cell carcinoma of the anal canal is usually treated with chemoradiation with something called the Nigro protocol, which is 5-FU, mitomycin C, and 4,500 centigrade radiation. Since the anal canal commonly drains to the inguinal lymph nodes, feel those for cancer, and also the radiation usually includes these nodes bilaterally prophylactically. If the anal squamous cell cancer comes back after chemoradiation, then you would need to do a salvage APR surgery and consider a muscle flap to the perineum. Anal melanoma can sometimes be mistaken for external hemorrhoids and can be amelanotic and fleshy colored. If you find one of these, local excision is better than APR surgery. APR does not show improved survival. Be sure to use a PET scan on the patient and consider a sentinel lymph node biopsy, as the inguinal node spread is common. Anal margin cancer is basically outside of the anal canal. Instead of chemoradiation, it is usually treated with surgical excision. If it is too big for surgery or recurs, then chemoradiation could be good for anal margin squamous cell carcinoma. Extramammary Paget's disease is adenocarcinoma in situ of the perianal skin. Bowen's disease is squamous cell carcinoma in situ of the perianal skin. Pabst Blue Ribbon is a mnemonic for that, P-A-B-S-T. A Buschke-Lowenstein tumor is a giant anal condyloma associated with HPV. Surgery, chemo, and radiation may all be needed to treat one of these. And with that, I think we will wrap it up. I hope that helped. Good luck.